Hi, everyone. Welcome. My name is Monroe Lovelady. I'm the board president of InConcert Sierra, and we're delighted to have you with us today. We have a really special concert for you today. We have two of our favorite artists with us, Spencer Myer, pianist, and Mario Diaz-Moresco with us today from New York. And of course, we have Mr. Ken Harden with us here in Penn Valley. And we're going to have a bit of a pre-concert forum. So with that, why don't we get started, Ken?
Okay. It's great to be talking to you guys coast to coast here.
Thanks, Ken. So nice to see you.
Yeah, it's pretty nice that we can do this since we're not able to get together to do things these days. So at least we can do this.
So. Absolutely. Couldn't have done this 20 years ago, for sure.
That's right. Yeah. So I wanted to start by acknowledging that when we initially did this program, what was it, back in 2014, I think, like that?
2015.
So it's been a while. It's amazing how time flies. I kind of foisted on you both the notion of doing a voice recital combined with a piano recital, kind of going back and forth between the two. So I wondered if you would talk a little bit about how since, in the time since we've done that, having done the recital and then reviewing it again, and maybe you've done this same kind of format since that time, how you feel about that now, how it worked out for you.
I think it's a really wonderful format, and I'm not sure if that was the first time that we had done it before in that way or not, but it's certainly something that we've done in recitals moving forward. I think that there's a couple of things that make it really advantageous. Number one, I think it's really wonderful to give that kind of variety to the audience. It can be very... it can become a long evening very quickly if it's all the same kind of combinations of sounds. But also I think that for a vocalist, you know, a full length recital is really quite a lot of singing. It's really actually much more than one would do even in an opera or in a stage play or a musical, because in stage works, you're off for 30 minutes or sometimes you're off for a whole act. And you really only sing for 10, 15 minutes at a time and maybe 5 minutes at a time, and then you get a break. So it's really helpful for the singer as well to have those breaks built in. And I think it helps us show interplay between repertoire in a really interesting way that wouldn't be available if it was just voice and piano.
Yeah, and being that I make the majority of my career as a soloist is why I adore playing for singers, but being that I'm an active soloist also, it kind of made sense. And I've seen that done in programs. I remember Don Upshaw came to Oberlin when I was a freshman with Richard Good, and he did some solos, he did some Brahms and things. So it's become, I think, more of a normal thing in vocal recitals.
Right, great, thank you. So maybe you could also talk just a little bit about I wanted to acknowledge the fact that we've just passed through Beethoven's 250th year, and the music world hasn't gotten to have as much of a celebration of that as we would have liked. So I'm imagining that 2021 will be more sort of a delayed celebration of that event, which just happened in December, I believe, is when the actual birthday was. Yeah. We're starting this program off with a Beethoven work, and I wondered if you guys would talk about the significance of that work a little bit, and then also follow up with a piece that even if people are aware of the song cycle, they may not be aware of its existence as a solo piano work. So,
absolutely. So the first work is a song cycle called An die Ferne Geliebte, to the distant beloved. And it's significant for several reasons. It's the first ever example of a song cycle, and that's a group of songs that are intended to be performed together. On the concert today, we'll have two complete song cycles, the first being the Beethoven, and then the last set of works on the concert, the songs of travel, are also a song cycle. And these contrast from the Duparc set, which are songs that are meant to stand individually. They don't thematically go together. So it's significant for that reason. It's also the first ever through composed song cycle. So normally, in a Schubert cycle, you do a number, there's a little break, you do a number, there's a little break. But Beethoven was really playing with form, and it's completely through composed, so there are no gaps in between the pieces musically.
And some of the transitions he does in the piano and with the voice, and how he ends one song and goes seamlessly into the next, are some of the most magical moments of the piece.
Yeah, it's actually a piece, interestingly, that is not performed all that often in our times. And I've read several different reasons for that. One of them is that people in the last 20, 25 years kind of felt that it was such a high, holy piece that people shied away from performing it. And I think that's really a shame, because it's some of the most beautiful Lieder and art song that was ever written.
Absolutely.
I think Liszt, in the Liszt solo transcription, interestingly, in a lot of Liszt transcriptions, he embellishes hugely and changes things around and whatnot. And I think the fact that his transcription of An die Ferne Geliebte is almost by the book, where he just sort of interweaves the melody with the actual accompaniment, by and large, for the most part, I think that's an indication of the reverence that he had for Beethoven and for the piece, that he really didn't feel it should be changed much at all.
Right. Right.
And I do think that so much of that reverence for the piece in the musical community comes from the text. The whole conceit of the cycle, of the text of the cycle is that there's this person singing songs of love to the person that they are not with. And it's only at the end, you know, it's interesting, throughout all the songs, he's sending his song through this aspect of nature, through that aspect of nature, you know, over the hills and through the clouds. But it's only at the end of the cycle where he says, and then I hear you, I'm going to get emotional, I hear you sing the song. And that's what makes him whole, is that the song is shared between him and his beloved.
Right, right. It is an absolutely amazing piece of music.
Yeah, it is. It's miraculous.
So on a more personal note, how are the two of you getting along during the pandemic? They're holed up in your apartment in New York. What kind of of musical adventures have you managed to engage in? And have you created new virtual content? Talk a little bit about what your experience has been.
Yeah, well, I mean, the highlight for us really over these last 9 months was there's an opera company in New York that does site-specific opera. So they do productions in locales that are very specific to the plot of the opera, like Marriage of Figaro in an outdoor courtyard or whatnot. So they had the idea, because An die Ferne Geliebte is about being away from your distant beloved, they had the idea to present An die Ferne Geliebte with a duo singing to a single ticket buyer over the phone. So we were one of the two duos, and we had this engagement in July and August for weekend after weekend after weekend. We did 100 performances of An die Ferne Geliebte with a computer set up right here with Google Voice and a nice microphone, and so we sang right here where you see us now to a single person or a couple over the phone. Yeah. And it was really, by that time it was still, This was June, July, August, so it was the feeling of isolation was still kind of fresh. There was really nothing live going on, and people were so hungry for a live experience.
Right.
And we often engaged with the people after the call for a few minutes and talked to them, and they were just so over the moon to have this experience. So that was really amazing.
Yeah, we were really taken aback by how much it meant to people to have something that was live and that was so personal. It was really a very moving experience. So we definitely want to thank On-Site Opera for that opportunity. And you know, it's funny, we have friends who say, oh, are you tired of An die Ferne Geliebte? And it's like, no, it's one of the best pieces in the repertoire.
Yeah.
The next recital we do in person, we will it'll be the first thing that we program.
But it gave us a taste of what Broadway performers go through doing eight shows a week.
Yeah, which we usually don't get in the classical world.
Exactly. And then we also, as a duo, because a lot of organizations knew we were a duo that lived together with a piano and we didn't have to distance from each other, we had a lot of engagements come up online.
Right. So
that was great.
And you've been doing lots of masterclass and online teaching. And
masterclasses and teaching. And
solo recitals as well.
Yeah. So
great. Well, you both look great, like you've come through this just fine. So, so good. So I want to take just a minute and explain a little bit to our audience today about some information that they might want to have before we go into the performance. And I should probably mention that most of the audience today probably knows who I am, but there may be a few that don't. And I'm happy to say that I am once again the artistic director of InConcert Sierra. I've been laid off from July 1st until December 31st. And Ken Harden, as Monroe said, and I'm delighted to be back at the helm again and doing my thing. So we're starting to do some booking and working on in the fall when we can come back with live concerts. So as far as today is concerned, there's some information that you all might be interested in accessing. So I'm gonna turn a little bit here so I can read so that I get this right, so I give you the correct information. So the video that you're going to see today is formatted with slides at the beginning of each work that give the title and the composer. So at the beginning of the Beethoven, for instance, the Ode to Ferne Geliebte, you're going to see the title of the work, Beethoven, and then you'll see the names of each of the songs, which as Mario and Spencer pointed out, there really is no pause as it goes through. They one flows right from the previous into the next. So you'll see that information at the beginning of each work in the concert as we go along. There's a little bit of commentary from Mario and Spencer about the program, which is from the original performance. And then for those of you that would like to actually download the program and have that on a piece of paper, or to be, if you're adept at flipping back and forth on your computer screen between what you're watching and looking at a document, you can download the program and the translations for the songs from our website, which is inconcertsierra.org. If you go to the homepage and click on the banner, then scroll down the page and you'll find about this concert, and it's very clear where to click and access that information, both the program and the translations. So if you would like to access that information, please feel free to do that. And then I'm gonna pass it back over to Mario just for a second, because I know he had some instructions for you regarding the accessing the program and the translations. So Mario.
So instructions, if you want to take them or not, I just always encourage audience members, myself included, when I go to leader recitals or to the opera, I often don't read the translations beforehand. And there's a reason for that. Number one, I do have a bit of facility with the language, so that helps. But I think that it's really important to be able to experience both what the composer is bringing to the room and also what the performers are bringing to the room without either keeping your head down in the translations as it's happening. I think it's very important to let yourself just experience it and see what nuances and colors and interesting words come out to you in the course of just experiencing it, you know, raw, as it were. And then if you want to go back and study the text later, or I think it's also very helpful to study the text beforehand so that you have a general idea of what to expect thematically, and then just to let it wash over you, I think is a really wonderful, natural experience that is one of the reasons that we go to the concert hall is for actual experience.
Yeah. So the concert will be up on YouTube after this initial presentation today. So like Mario said, if you do want to go back, study the translations a little bit after you've heard this initial performance of it and get a little more familiarity from a different perspective, if you will, and then go back and listen to it again and see how it affects you a second hearing with a little more information, you certainly will have that opportunity. You can listen to it 2 times, 3 times, 8 times, whatever you might like to do. So I think many of you will be very engaged and interested, particularly in the Beethoven, but the entire recital is beautiful, definitely has an arc to it. Mario said, there are two song cycles involved. So you'll be able to do as much of that as you would like to do. And with that, I think let's go back to Monroe and see if there's any other housekeeping we need to take care of. And so Monroe.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you to Mario for explaining about the term song cycle. I always wondered about the origin and exactly what it meant. So thank you, Mario, for that. And well, what do you think, gentlemen? Do we have anything else to cover before we get started?
I think we hit most of the points. Yeah.
All right. Super. Well, once again, we'd like to welcome back our good friends, baritone Mario Diaz-Moresco and Spencer Myer, pianist from New York. Let's get on with the music.
Thanks, guys.
Möchte ich sein, dort im Ruhm. Mal könnt ein Mädchen dir erspähen, bricht sie mir viel tausendmal. Seht ihr, warten sie dann gehen, söhnend in den stillen Tal. Lasst meine Bild vor ihren Stehen in den luftigen Himmelssaal. Stehen, die nun herbstlich fall und kahl, klagt ihr, wie mir ist geschieden, klagt ihr, Vöglein, meine Qual. Stille Weste bringt ihm Wehen hin zu meiner Herzenswahl, meine Seufzer, die vergehen wie der Sonne. Liebes Flehen, lass sie weg, klein, klein und schmal, treu in deinen Fugen singen, meiner Tränen ohne Zahl, ohne Zahl. Diese Wolken in den Höhen, diese Vöglein unsere Zug, werden dich umhüllen sehen. Leichten Flug. Diese Weste werden spielen, schelten dir um Wang und Brust in den seidenen Locken wühlen. Teilt ich mit euch diese Lust. Hin zu dir von jenen Hügen nimmt sich dieses Bächlein alt, fehlt mir Bild. Unverweilt, fließ zurück, dann unverweilt, ja unverweilt.
Thank you.
Love.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Wow, wasn't that a fabulous first half? That was really, really fabulous. So this was 5 years ago that this concert took place and was filmed. So I have a question for our good friends Mario and Spencer. What does it feel like to see yourselves 5 years later?
Well, first off, I just want to acknowledge how wonderful the videography is. I was really blown away when I went back and watched it at how seamless it all is and how good it looks. I'm also quite a bit thinner. You know, you get older and things like that. But yeah.
I mean, it's for me, watching myself and listening to myself, I have a lot of friends that hate to listen to themselves on recordings because they always feel there's so much they would have done differently. And for me, it's a little bit the opposite. I've always been, in my own playing, it's the musical aspects and the aspects of sound and tone color and musicianship that I've always been very comfortable with and very sort of happy with. So I listened to myself 5-10 years ago and I think I would probably do it exactly the same way. But it's the technique that has always come more difficultly to me, and I've had to work harder at that. And I think in the recent years of teaching more, I've learned a lot more about my own technique. So when I watch myself play 5 to 10 years ago, I think, oh, I would move my hands a little bit differently there, and I would do this and that. And certainly singers' techniques are changing by the day and by the week.
Yeah, it's with a singer, you know, it's when you're instrument is your body, and your body goes through all sorts of hormonal and physical changes all the time.
Yeah.
You know, every day is a little bit different, and the point of vocal technique is to make things as consistent as possible. And 5 years ago, I had not met my current vocal teacher that I'm with. It's a wonderful soprano named Diana Soviero. There's an amazing video of her doing a scene from Suor Angelica. If you look that up on YouTube, that is really fantastic. But there are just a lot of, it's interesting because a lot of times when you don't have a chance to listen to something, and you only have your memory, and to a singer, the sound that is in our head is not the sound that's in the audience. So going back and listening to it, I was like, oh wow, there are so many things that actually were really well done and wonderful, but better than I remember it. But also there are many things now that I would physically be able to do differently because of different technical tools that I've picked up along the way. But that's part of maturing as an artist and growing. You know, you never finish. A good artist is never finished. It's never something that's done on the shelf. It's someone who always keeps evolving. So yeah.
Well, that's cool. You know what all this means, of course, that we have to do this again.
Oh, yes. That sounds good to us.
I'd like to piggyback on Mario's comment about the video and the videography and say a big thank you to our good friend Mark Triolo, who did the original videography and has done editing for all of these virtual Third Sunday programs that we've been able to present over this season when we can't get together in person. So a big thank you, Mark, to you for doing
yes,
that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, beautifully done.
So I want to talk just briefly. I know that our audience is going to be anxious to get back to the concert, but I wanted to mention that at In Concert, we have a composer's project, which is an ongoing thing connected to the school year calendar. And so that group of young students who are learning composition and learning a great deal about music in the process, studying with Mark Vance, are working hard on their first project, which is setting a poem to music. Each student selects a poem and Mark works with them to make sure that it's something that will work well, that is not too long or too esoteric, too something. And they are well along working on those projects. And what was it, about 2 weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks, Mario and Spencer met with this group of students. They have a regular Saturday morning online class where the students all meet together. And Mario and Spencer met with them on a Saturday morning and talked with them about the process of composing for voice and an accompanying instrument. Each of the students can use a single accompanying instrument. Most of them are using piano. And so I'd love to have you guys talk just a little bit about what your experience was in talking with these kids, seeing some of what they've worked on at that point. So,
yeah. I have had the wonderful opportunity of working with quite a number of composers, both established and well known, and also new and upcoming composers. I've been a resident singer for American Opera Project and their incubation program, Composers in the Voice, for two cycles now, and then I've also premiered works by a number of other composers. So I've worked with a lot of composers. And the best composers always find that there is, you know, they have their ideas and they have things that they want to, a point of view that they want to get across, but they're always listening to the performers. And I think that was something that I really wanted to impart to the young students. I was also very taken aback that they were so young. It was incredible to me that these high school and middle school kids were writing at such an incredible level. It's so encouraging to see because, you know, it's like, where do they come from? Well, they come from programs like this, where they're guided and given an opportunity to express something and to develop it. And I loved it much more than I thought I would, actually.
And they were so open.
They were, yeah.
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 Great.
Yeah, and I think the work that they've done, that they are doing is really wonderful. And again, for at such a young age, it's really quite impressive. So,
and writing for the voice is a tough thing and a very specific thing. And I think Mario's experience with working with composers, he was really able to impart a lot of great helpful ideas to them about what is a little more awkward in the voice and what is more seamless and how should you make a phrase go up and down and how does it work in the voice and a lot of great ideas.
I mean, I think it takes even well-established and very famous composers almost their whole life to really learn how to write for the voice. Again, it's one of those things that's an ever-evolving process, and it depends on who you're writing for, you know, and I hope that that I was able to impart that to the kids, and just to keep them open and flexible and always listening.
Yeah,
absolutely. I was fortunate to be able to hear most of that class, and I was really pleased with the kinds of things you imparted to them and the way you did that, and actually giving some of the kids feedback on a little bit of some excerpts of the piece that they had worked on so far, that kind of thing. And I'm just gonna say that I think that this is a nod to Mark Vance, the teacher for these kids, that this poetry and song using the voice as a vehicle for their first project is absolutely brilliant, because we always talk about as musicians, the voice is the original musical instrument. And it's always the instrument that we all as instrumentalists go back to. We talk about how do we make a phrase sing, and always the references to the voice and what the voice brings to music. So starting for these kids at that point with having to work on how to write for the voice and then move forward into writing for instruments, I think is absolutely brilliant. So hats off to Mark Vance.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, hats off to InConcert Sierra for supporting a program like that.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's really important to foment and to support these young people who are trying to find a way in this art form. And you know, there aren't always a lot of opportunities for that. So I think it's really important to provide that.
Right. Yeah. Thank you. So the other thing I want to mention is just a little preview for our third Sunday concert, virtual concert in February, which will be on February 21st, 2021. Well, there's a lot of twos and ones in that date.
Yeah.
2021. We will be presenting the recording of our May 2012, performance with the Sierra Master Chorale and Orchestra of The Armed Man, A Mass for Peace by the Scottish composer Carl Jenkins. And I think probably for folks who in our audience who were able to see one of the performances when the Sierra Master Chorale has presented that, that you probably will want to see it again. You probably will remember it, the very impactful piece of music. And if you have not seen it, I really recommend that you take the opportunity. It's a very compelling performance of the work and a very important work. So please join us on February 21st for that. And again, that concert will stay online for people to come back to and be able to view more times in the future. So Monroe, is there anything else we need to take care of? Oh, Monroe, you're muted. We're not here.
Oh, dear. Sorry about that. Thank you, Ken.
That's okay.
A couple of quick things. So, Ken, first of all, I'd like to say welcome back. We missed you, and we're delighted to have you back on board.
Thank you very much.
And we'd also like to say a huge thanks to our guest today, baritone Mario Moresco, Diaz-Moresco, sorry, Mario, and Spencer Meyer with us today from New York. So we're delighted to see you again, and we look forward to having you guys back in the future.
Thank you so much. And I would like to add, there are two encores at the very end of the program. Just make sure to stay tuned
for those.
The first, well, I won't spoil it. The first is a Schubert, which I think on retrospect, after singing a full recital, Schubert is maybe not the choice that I would make again for an encore, but you live and you learn. And then the second one is a musical theater number that is dear to all of our hearts.
Yes.
So keep watching. I didn't mention that
recital was a full house, which was, of course, I'm sure delightful for you guys and absolutely delightful for us also.
Yes.
Thank you for that.
Thanks, everybody. With that, let's get back to the music.
Thank you.
We're so happy to see you all here this afternoon. To contrast with the romantic French repertoire that we ended the first half with, this is some impressionist French repertoire. Debussy and Ravel both apparently hated the term impressionism, but as you will see from particularly this first piece, there's really a reason they are so compared to the French impressionist painters. Ravel is really a painter at the piano, and a large portion of his piano music is, like Jeux, character pieces with descriptive titles that point your imagination in a certain direction and just paint this picture so just brilliantly. So, but what I like about the Sonatine, which I wanted to mention in particular, he actually wrote this in a composition competition. The requirement of which was the first movement of a sonatina, no more than 72 bars, and his was apparently a few bars too long, and he was disqualified. So he decided to make it into a three-movement sonatina, regardless. But what I love is that he is conforming to the classical sonata form of Mozart and Haydn and Beethoven, but amidst this, he still imbues his Ravel magic at creating colors and sounds and atmospheres at the piano that you will hear so clearly in Chautauqua, but in a classical form of the Sonatine, he does the same thing. So I hope you enjoy these two pieces of Ravel.
Give to me the life I love, let the lake go by me. Give the jolly heaven above and the byway nigh me. Bread in the bush with stars to see, bread I dip in the river. There's the life for a man like me. There's the life forever. Let the blow fall soon or late, let what will be o'er me. Keep the face of earth around and the road before me. Well, I ask not hope nor love, nor a friend to know me. All I ask, the heaven above and the road below me. Oh, let autumn fall on me, where a field I live. pleasures and toys for your delight, of birdsong and morning and starshine at night. I will make a palace fit for you and me, of green days in forest and blue days at sea. I will make my kitchen, and you shall keep your room, where white flows the river and bright glows the bloom, and you shall wash your linen and keep your body white in rainfall at morning and dewfall at night. And this shall be for music when no one else is near. Sure.
a little bit of Schubert.
Solid.